All right, we are going live on Facebook. Welcome, everyone. This is Pestalina with the Thought of the Day. Thanks for joining me today on The Thought for Today. I have a special guest with me today, Shelly Johnson. And Shelly is a nurse, and she's also a businesswoman, and she's writing her book about her life story on how God set her free. So tonight I'm going to be interviewing Shelly. We're going to talk about all the good things that God has done to set her free. And so I hope you'll share this with your friends and family, and stay tuned for a good time tonight as we talk more about what God has done for Shelly. So Shelly, I want to welcome you to the program tonight. How are you doing today?
Oh, good. Thank you for having me.
Well, you're welcome. I'm so glad that you could join me tonight. So yes, Shelly, so tell me about yourself, and you know, maybe just start like who you are, and you know, a little bit about yourself, and then we'll get into what God has done for you.
Well, right now I'm kind of helping my mother, my elderly mother. And I came back to my hometown because my dad had cancer, and I had been living out west, and I came back to help him before he died. And I'm glad I did. The Lord told me to do it. And he said, go back and help your parents. And he showed me that it's really important that people help their parents, because what's the scripture that with long life, he'll satisfy you, and honor thy father and thy mother so that your life may go well with you. And at first I didn't really want to do it because we had some falling outs, but the Lord has patched everything up pretty much and smoothed things out. And I obeyed God. And so I'm still there because I'm helping my mother now. My dad passed away. And I'm just working as a nurse. I've been a nurse for 30 some years, and doing my other little things, and just trying to follow the leading of the Lord. Amen. In my life. Yeah.
Amen. Amen. Well, that's really interesting. Yeah. You know, we're doing a tag team preaching on Sunday with my husband. We always do it for Valentine's Day. Sunday's Valentine's Day. And yes. So I'm studying on love and honor, and honoring your parents is a big thing. He said, honor your parents, yes. You know, your father and your mother. And it says it's the only commandment with a promise. And the promise is that you'll live long, have a long life. You'll live, yes. You know, have a long life. So yes. There's, you know, that it is very important. And it has to do with if we honor our parents, we're ultimately going to honor the Father God, who is ultimate authority. You know, it's just it's a position. Honor is a position thing, of position. It's, you know, you don't honor them because they're great people, or they're, you know, they've always never done anything bad. You honor them because of the position that God gave them, you know.
Yes, so, correct. Yes, that's what God. He showed me. Yeah, that's Amen. What he showed me. Yeah. Amen. He said I want you to be a witness to other people, and yeah. Take care of them, and so they took care of me. I got to take care of them now.
Yeah, that's awesome. That's awesome. Well, so Shelly, so tell me about your journey with the Lord. So you, how old were you when you came to know the Lord?
28.
28. Wow.
Yes.
So before that, you know, rewind. What kind of a life did you grow up with?
Well, I'd say we just had average life with my family. We had enough to a good life, and I lived in a small town, but then I moved away. I went to college, and I'd go to parties once in a while. I was always finding the girls that were going out and having fun, and just doing my own thing. And I really, you know, I believed in God, but I didn't have a relationship with him. And I grew up believing in God, that my family would sent me to Sunday school, and we would go to church on Christmas and Easter, at least Christmas and Easter. But anyway, I found the Lord on my own through the circumstances that I wanted to share, the wild story that happened to me, because I haven't heard anybody else have a story like mine. And when you said you wanted to have people give their testimony, and the Lord's been telling me, tell people what happened to you. Tell people what happened and what I, how I came into your life. And he opened my eyes up to know how real he is. And I was born again. I didn't even really know I was born again. I just knew something happened to me and I knew Jesus. And then I went from there, and I didn't, I just had to kind of punt my way and, figure things out.
So tell me, what made you want to even search for God? If, you know, if you grew up, you thought you probably were good enough to get to heaven. You know, you went to church, you know, Sunday, once, twice a year, you know,
maybe you probably, a few more times.
And you didn't probably do anything, you know, majorly bad. So you considered yourself a good enough person to get to heaven.
Right. And you can't work your way to heaven. Right.
Well, so, but what gave you the idea that you needed to have a personal relationship with the Lord? Then did you have like a heart change? Did you hear about it? Did you just seek after him? How did you, you know, come to the point where you were seeking for him?
Well, I was desperate, but you know, in high school, we had a bunch of Christian kids that were born again. And, you know, I always listened to them, but I wasn't at that point. I wasn't going to join them, but I did listen to them. And I never made fun of them. And some people made fun of them, but I never did. And I did listen to them. But I thought, I'm not doing that. At that time, there was no way you were going to have me do that, go with them. But anyway, I was in a desperate place because these witches had deceived me and set me up in different things and my living situations and harassed me and called me. It was a 10-11 month ordeal.
So tell me, how did you get involved and how did you know that there were witches?
Well, I didn't know until after I was involved with this lady as a friend. And I had moved. I had been a flight attendant, and then I lost the job when Northwest took over Republic Airlines, and I was in Republic, and they were letting go of several people and the gate agents and whatnot. But anyway, I came back to Minneapolis and stayed with one of my friends because I was going to find a job, and I had been living south down in Georgia and Memphis. And I came back to Minneapolis and went over to one of my friend's place and said, well, I'm going to have to find a place, an apartment. I'm going to have to get a job. And things are different now. And so she said, well, I know of a lady that can hook you up. She's a headhunter and has all kinds of apartments. She finds people's apartments. She's got 1,000 some apartments. And I said, oh, great. And hook me up with her. And so she gave me her number and said, well, Ruth, my friend Ruth said, and she knew she was living in Bloomington, up there in the cities. And she said, just tell her what you're looking for and she'll find you the best thing that she could do. And so I did. And this lady, befriended me and was very friendly and cheerful and let's go out to lunch and let's go shopping sometime. And she found me a place that I really liked, and it was in Richfield, Minnesota. And she just pursued me in a way, friendship base. And I just met her and thought, well, you know, I'll befriend her and go out to lunch and have some fun because she seemed like fun. And I was that type of person, and meeting people up in the Minneapolis since I moved back. And she continued to pursue me. But then they did things to scare me. And I did not know it was them. And they were having people call me on the phone and say things to me. And I thought, well, who did I give my phone number to? I didn't give it to anybody that I know that at any bar. I didn't give my phone number. How does this person have my phone number? And they were saying threatening things and describing what I looked like and saying, we're watching you. And I became so petrified. I had called the police and they had put a tap on my phone.
So now why do you think that it was this woman? And you say some, they, was it more than one person that you were working with?
Well, after I knew her longer, I knew they had a group. They had a group of witches, and they had their regular meetings, just like Christians go to church. They've got their meetings too, or parties, or whatever they do. I never did go, but I was invited. And I met a couple of them because I had been over to somebody's house. But I figured it out later because they wanted to get me into fear so that I would move out. And she'd say, move in with me, move in with me. And it was a setup. But at the time, I didn't know it until afterwards, because they came after me for 10, 11 months. And then I finally got Jesus, and then they left me alone.
Praise God. Well, so, you know, well, the Bible says in 2 Timothy 1:7, it says, God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. And it says in 1 John that, you know, that perfect love casts out fear, but fear has torment. So,
yes,
you know, that's, and that's a big thing that's going on in the earth today with all this COVID stuff. It's based on fear, and people are paranoid. And so that is a big thing. That is, you know, Satan's tactic is lies and the fear. Devil. The devil's tactics.
And I hadn't been with, I was not a born again believer at that time. So I don't know all the Bible scriptures, but I knew they were scaring me. They were scaring the living daylights out of me. And she kept saying, move in with me, move in with me, move in with me. And I found a place way out in Minnetonka. Way out, far out in the Minnetonka, where all the boats are docked. And so she was trying to isolate me from my friends and family. And my cousin would call me and she'd say, she's not here. So she did, they accomplished what they set out to do, because I gave notice and moved out of that place because they had made me so scared. And I had my phone tapped. I had called the Richfield police and said, somebody's stalking me. They're describing what I look like, so I know they've seen me, with the clothes I was wearing and whatnot. And this went on for a while, and I thought somebody was going to break in my apartment and get me, and I don't know what they were going to do, but I just was so afraid. And that was their tactic, and to get me to move in with her. And so I did. I moved in with her, and she didn't expose to me that she was a witch. She kept that a secret. And I was not going to church. I was just my happy old go lucky self, and working and trying to have fun in life. And then I moved in with her, and she exposed it to me later. But she had been doing mind things to me. And I was back then, I wanted to be into vitamins as well. And she said, before she exposed to me that she was a witch, she said, well, I have friends that are in a real great company of vitamins and herbs and things. And I said, oh, well, I'd be interested in finding out. And so she sent me over to their house in Minnetonka. And I went over there and I came in, and the house was really bizarre looking. It was very empty. The windows were open and the wind was blowing, and cats were in the house running around. And there was a big pan of water by the door. And she said, this lady came in. Are you Shelly? And I said, yes, I am. And she said, well, I need to wash your feet. You come into my home, I have to humble myself and wash your feet. And I said, oh, no, no, no. I just thought, this is uncomfortable. This is strange. And so she said, just dip it in the water and I'll towel dry your feet. And I thought of Jesus at that time, because I did know Jesus washed the disciples' feet. And I was not a Christian, a born again Christian or a heavy Christian at all. But I did believe in God and was a good person. And I went in there, and then she says, well, come over here and see all the vitamins. And then all of a sudden a man appeared. And they were both looking at me from head to toe. And back then, you know, I was a cute 28-year-old. And they were checking me out. And they all of a sudden, they identified themselves. And the man says, I'm the priest, a high priest, and this is the master. And I'm standing there thinking, what? Oh, my gosh, I'm in the wrong place. I need to get out of here. But she had sent me home with some tapes. I tried to be just kind and polite and talked just a little bit and said I had to get going. And the alarms went off in my head like, what is a high priest and a master? It doesn't sound good. It doesn't sound like anything that I'm involved in or my family and nothing I know about. And she had sent me home with a book full of tapes. And I went over to my friend's house afterwards. Very good friends of mine, Renee and Gary. And we started playing them and there were subliminal messages in there. And there was messages in there, do not listen to your parents. And different things were coming out in between the talking about these so-called vitamins that were called light force. And we looked it up not too long ago and they're still on the internet, light force, and they don't look good. They look like they're into some supernatural witchcraft thing. It just doesn't look appealing to me. I'd never take them in a million years after these people were involved in them. And anyway, I was polite because I thought, you know, I can't cause a ruckus in somebody's house or I might be a dead person reversed or something, a missing person. And I ended up calling the police about 3-4 times in the 10 months over different situations because I was so afraid for my life. I thought they were going to do something to me. They were isolating me and had me move out to Minnetonka. And then later on, I was doing laundry and she was always chasing me around the house and calling me up when I was at work. And I'd say, I can't talk when I'm at work. And she'd follow me around the house. And I'd say, would you quit following me around the house? And she was trying, they actually had told me, we're trying to break your mind. We're trying to break you. And it was getting to me. And all this whining, and she was whining about this and whining and just all these different things that she was doing to me. And it was part of their trying to break my will and my mind. And every weekend that I had off from work, I would take off and get out of that house. And because I thought, here I signed a lease with this woman, a year lease. And I thought, I am in a trap. How am I going to get out of this? And still trying to work, you know, but it was getting weary. And she was accomplishing what she was trying to do. But I stayed tough and I just told myself, I've got to beat this. And they called me on the telephone one night. I was in bed and this is when we had a lot of landlines and the master called me and said, we are trying to break you and you are too tough. And I thought, you're not going to break me. I was like, I was going to be stubborn and tough. And, anyway, I had told my friends I'd leave every weekend for a couple of months and I'd say, I've got to get out of this situation. I don't know how I'm going to get out of it. I'm living with this lady. And then I was washing my laundry one day and she stood there by the kitchen table and she says, I'm a witch. And I go, what? And I said, oh, sure you are. Yeah, sure you are. I thought, I'm not going to play like I'm afraid. I am not going to show this woman that I'm afraid, but I was afraid. I was terrified living with this woman and this thing came out of her face. It came and it went back in her face and I saw it with my eyes and I wasn't a believer at that time, a born again believer. There's a difference. And I would go to church, like I say, once in a while, but I was not a born again believer at that time. And I saw this thing come out of her face and back in and she wanted me to see it while she was telling me she was a witch. And I thought, I'm not going to show her that I'm terrified, but I was terrified because I thought, what did I get myself into? And I didn't ask for this and they pursued me. And so I just said, oh, sure you are. Sure you are. And I just said, tell me another one. Tell me another one. And then I continued to do my laundry and try to go up into my bedroom and put my laundry away. And then I took off and went over to my other friend's house, my other friend, Renee. And I told her all this stuff that had happened. And she said, you have got to get out of that house and leave. And she said, pack up your suitcases and come over here. And I had a weapon in every corner of my bedroom because I thought they're going to attack me. She's got a group of people, and she'd take off on weekends and say, I'm going with my group. And she'd pack a little bag, a night overnight bag, and they all got together and they go and stay overnight together. And, you know, you hear of things that witches do, and I'm sure they were doing it. And so anyway, I saw all this, and I was terrified because I thought I wasn't looking for anything like this. And that was not the direction in life that I had planned on going. And I told her so. I said, I'm not going your direction. And she just kept pursuing me. Would you like to join us? Would you like to come on with us? Come on, honey. Come on, honey. And I'm like, she'd say, loosen up. And I said, no. And we're trying to break you. And I said, you're not breaking me. And anyway, I had to be tough as nails to fight this, because the forces, whatever they were praying, they do have some kind of power. But greater is he that is in me, that is in the world, which I know now that Jesus has more power than they do. But they must have been doing something on me, and they were doing it on my mind. And I kept saying to my other nurse friend, Rose, I'm going to crack up. I've got to get out of here. She's whining, following me, calling me, driving behind me. And they're calling me on the phone when I'm in bed at night. And I said, I've got to get out of here. And Renee had said, pack your bags up and come over here. And so I said, I'm out of here. And I thought, I'll have to deal with this lease that I signed for a year in Minnetonka on a lake. And it was a nice twin home. And I'll have to deal with all this later, because I got to pay rent here. And then I've got to work. And, you know, it just was like, I could hardly get to work anymore. I was calling in sick every once in a while, because the stress was like way to the top. I couldn't take it anymore. And so before I left and went over to my girlfriend's house, she invited me to come to her. Oh, she had an apartment. She was like 28 years old too. And she had an apartment in Roseville, Minnesota. Before I did that, I got on my knees and I cried out to God. I said, if you're real, God, oh my God, I need you, God. If you're real, I need help. I was so scared for my life. They were asking me about my financial status, and I just thought that they were going to take me and hide me somewhere and do something to me. And because they were, the stuff that they had set me up and made me move out there and isolate me. And my cousin would call and she'd say, she's not here. She's not here. And I heard, I overheard it one night. And I said, what did you tell her that for? I'm here. And so then I'd call my cousin Jeannie back and she'd say, well, she told me you weren't there. I said, Jean, these people are after me. And I said, I got to get out of this place. And then I happened to tell my mother, and that was a person I shouldn't have told, because she wanted to get involved, and she had dreamed all these things up in her head that weren't even true. And so then I was having trouble with my mother because she was dreaming things up by just a few things I had told her. And she's very anxious and started coming over and yelling and getting involved when I wish she would have stayed out of it, because I was going to get out of this on my own. And I should have never said anything to her, because it opened up a whole nother can of worms that I had to deal with. So anyway, I moved in with Renee and Gary and slept on their couch, because it was a one bedroom apartment they had. They had just gotten married and they were in an apartment yet. They hadn't got a house yet. And I said, I got to get out of this lease. And I called that lady up and I said, you're getting out of there. I said, I'm not living with you anymore. I've got Jesus. I called upon the name of the Lord and you shall be saved. And I got saved and I didn't even know what I was doing. I just cried out to God.
So you said you cried out to God. So how do you know, you said about Jesus and about being saved, or did you find out about that later? I mean, did you cry out to Jesus? Did you say, Jesus, save me? What did you say?
Yeah, no, I just said, Jesus, I need help. If you're real, I need help. I said, Jesus, help me. If you're real, I need help. And, but I was calling upon the name of the Lord, and it says, you shall be saved. Well, this is what I know now, but I didn't know any Bible.
So what did you feel? What did you sense then when you called upon the name of the Lord? Did you know something happened?
Yes, I knew something happened. And then I had, Renee had hooked me up with her brother, who she says, my brother knows Jesus. And Dana, her brother, Dana. And I went over to her house and with my suitcases, and she says, let's call my brother tonight. And she did not know that I cried out to the Lord before I went over to her apartment. And so we called her brother. And here back then I was smoking. I would have a beer and then I would take a Valium once in a while. I said, because this is, I'm about ready to lose my mind. I was so stressed out with these people messing with me. And they did a lot of things. It went on for 10 months, 10, 11 months. And I thought I was going to have a nervous breakdown. I didn't even know what one was, but they told me they were trying to break me and they were doing a pretty good job, but they didn't succeed. And I found God. And then I told Renee, and she was so scared for me. She says, well, let's call my brother. He knows God. He's with the Church of the Nazarene. And he's going to school to be a pastor. I said, okay, fine, anything. I was just so beside myself. And I just can't tell everybody all what's been going on, one person, and in one time, all these things that they had done to me, and what I've seen with my own eyes. And so anyway, we called him up and he says, well, are you right with God? And I said, no, I'm not. I swear. I swore once in a while, cussed. I was smoking and drinking and running around, going to parties before. And I wasn't perfect, but I was a good person though. But I mean, I was not I knew I had sin in my life. And he says, well, you need to get right with God. And I sat there and I thought, well, I can't go wrong with that. I guess there's nothing Amen. Wrong with that. I said, yeah, I do. I'm not right with God. It just showed me I've got sin in my life and I'm not right with God. And so he said, you need to ask God for forgiveness, ask him into your heart. And I said, I will. And then he said, well, you know, me and my roommate, he was a single guy and he was going to Bible college. And he had worked for Hewlett Packard for like 20 years before that. And God had called him to be a minister. And he was, I don't know, in his 30s, I think. I'm not quite sure of all the numbers. But anyway, he went to Church of the Nazarene out in Colorado Springs. And so I was talking to this man in Colorado Springs, and I was in Roseville, Minnesota. Didn't know this guy from Beans, but he was very nice. And he said, me and my roommate will pray for you all night tonight. I was telling him all the stuff they had done to me and what a mess I was in. And here I was signed a lease and have to pay rent here. And I was couldn't even concentrate and to go to work. I was calling in sick all the time. And I absolutely couldn't concentrate. And then I had a weapon in every corner of my bedroom because I thought they were going to attack me in my bedroom. I had a bat in one corner, a booze bottle in one. I was going to crack it over their head. And I had an iron in one corner. And I didn't own a gun. And I had things I was going to clobber them with or throw at them. And I was just beside myself. And he said, me and my roommate are going to pray for you all night. And I was like, wow, I've never had anybody pray for me all night. I have never even seen my parents pray for me. They're good people. They always say they're Christian people, but I never saw them pray. And we didn't have a Bible in the house until I got confirmed in the Lutheran church at 15, 16 years old. So the only Bible we had was the one that I knew about, but they had little Bibles and that was their little Bibles when they were young in a drawer somewhere that they had gotten when they were little kids. But anyway, I just was amazed that this man was going to pray for me. And then I went to bed that night on the couch. I got up the next day and I knew Jesus was alive. Something had happened to me. I said, Jesus is alive. He is really alive. He is real. I told my girlfriend and she goes, oh no, you're just like my brother. Something happened to you. She goes, something happened to you.
Praise
you're
God.
Just like my, Amen. I lost my friend. She lost her friend. She lost her old friend because I was different. And the difference was I really had gotten Jesus. Amen. And he had called me again. He says, call me every day or call me every other day. And he says, you know, you can't smoke anymore. And I told him, I was sitting there smoking. I was having a beer. I had taken a Valium. I was like, I can't take this. I'm going to lose my mind. And my friend, she smoked cigarettes. Back then, a lot of women smoked cigarettes, you know, and nurses did too. The whole cafeteria was full of smoke, but now they can't even smoke on the property. And doctors were bumming cigarettes. Can you give me a cigarette? And, but anyway, she smoked cigarettes too. And I totally was addicted. Totally was addicted to cigarettes. Craved them, had them every day. 10 years. I was kind of hiding them all the time from family members and my mother and father. I never smoked in front of them. And anyway, he said, you can't smoke anymore. The Holy Spirit's in you. You're with God now. And I said, okay, okay. And I had that one last pack. And I said, I'm going to never smoke them again. And I threw it in the garbage can. And I tell you, I was delivered. I mean, just by my action of faith, I think. Now I said, I just threw them in the garbage. I knew nothing of the Bible, but I just did it because he said, you can't smoke and have Jesus. And I thought, well, that's probably right. You know, I went along with this guy because I was so overwhelmed with the whole Jesus experience that I said, tell me more. I'm hungry. I'm hungry. And so he was reading Bible scriptures to me, and I was like a little bird with a worm. Gobble, 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 because I hadn't read the Bible. I don't even know. I didn't even own a Bible. It was at my mother's house from confirmation, and I hadn't had one since I was 28 years old. So that's 12 years before that. And he says, you need to get a Bible and start reading. You need to go to church every Sunday. And then I thought to myself, I want people that really believe in Jesus, that really know Jesus. I know Jesus. And if I go back to that Lutheran church, they don't act like I do. They don't act like he does. I got to find a church where they know Jesus like I do. And I can't go back to the Lutheran church because what I grew up in, I mean, they go to church, but they go home, but they don't act like they really know Jesus. And I never really knew Jesus going to the Lutheran church. Neither did my parents. And, I knew that I had to find something else, find where to go. And I later on found out, well, there's born again churches. I never knew a thing about it. And I said, well, this is not it. I went back to the Lutheran church by myself. And I said, this isn't it because these people don't know. I know God's alive. I know he's real. I've got to find some. So I got to find somebody else. And he kept telling, then he'd call me up and he'd say, you got to find a born again church. Well, I really didn't even know what born again was, but I knew something had happened to me. Something happened. I changed. I knew God was alive. And my girlfriend was kind of turned off. I kind of lost my friend. She said, oh, no, you're like my brother. Oh, she just was like, I lost you. I lost you, Shelly. I thought, no, you didn't. I'm still the same, but I know Jesus. I know he's alive. I kept saying, he's alive.
Amen.
And so I thought, well, I've got to contact these people from high school that talked about Jesus. I remembered back the Jesus high schoolers, Craig Kessner, Laurie Broughton, Rick Mole. And I had talked to somebody. Oh, the guy in Colorado. He says, go to the Church of the Open Door. And so I had to find the address and I was going everywhere by myself. I had no Christian friends. Something happened to me and I was going to find other people that knew Jesus. And you can't explain this to some people because they won't take it. They won't receive it.
Yeah.
And even my own girlfriend turned away slightly.
Yeah. Well, that's true. I know when I received Jesus, I was 14 and I knew, and my family wasn't saved. I never went to church except for when somebody picked me up to go to like a Bible school camp or something. But I remember when I got saved and I came out of the youth meeting and it was in the basement of a bookstore and I looked up to the sky and the sky was bluer. The green was grasser, grass was the grass was greener, sky was bluer. Yeah. And I knew something had happened. And like you
something
said, after that
happened,
I just wanted Jesus. Like you said, I want to know the Bible. And I want to know people who knew Jesus, you know?
Yeah. Yes. Because I didn't want to go somewhere and they just weren't equally yoked, like the Bible says. And so this, the man in Colorado, Dana, he told me to go to this open door. Well, I went to the open door. I was doing everything he told me to do. He said, "There, go to the Christian bookstore." I said, "Christian bookstore? I thought you just went to Target and found a Bible. I didn't know there was even such a thing as a Christian bookstore." And I thought, well, you just go to Target and get a Bible. You know? And so anyway, I went to this Christian bookstore and it just blew me away. And I says, wow. And then I find there was people in there that, you know, were born again. And so I went to the open door and there was my high school classmate, Craig Kessner. And I ran up to him and said, "I know Jesus, I am saved." And he was about flipped. He just about flipped his lid. "Shelly Johnson has got Jesus?" And I said, "Yes, I do." And he was like so happy. And I said, "I got to tell him right away." And he told me to keep going there. I think he was moving or something. So I didn't see him very much after that. But he was going to tell the other classmates that had been born again. And they were like, "We didn't expect her out of all the classmates to be with Jesus." And I said, "Yep, he said, God surprises you." But I told him my story that these witches were pursuing me and they scared me right to Jesus. And I really thought my life was going to end, or they were going to do something to me and they were going to hide me somewhere. And I was going to be a missing person. And so I had even called the Minnetonka police. And I asked the cop to come out one night, and she was in the apartment or townhome. And I asked the cops to come out, Minnetonka Police Department. And I got in the cop car and I told them the whole story. "These people are witches. They're after me. They made me move out here. They were doing things to me, trying to break my mind. And there's other ones living right down the road. And there's the master and the high priest." And I said, "I don't want anything to do with it. But if I'm missing, would you please document it that I called you and said, if I'm a missing person, that the witches took me?" And he just looked at me, this cop, and I sat in the police car and he just sat and looked at me and he wouldn't say one word. I think he couldn't believe the story. And I said, "They're living right down there and she's in here and she's trying to break my mind." And I said, "I can't hardly take it anymore." And then what happened was eventually after I had been at my friend's house and then I knew Jesus, then I was trying to work because with all this going on, I could hardly function. And I was excited about God, but you know, things were just a mess. And I said, "I'm going to go to the landlord and beg him to please break my lease and just please and tell him the story." And she was with all her men all the time. And she'd burn holes in the rugs and all this stuff. And I said, I don't live like that. So I went to this landlord and I had a year lease. He could have hold me to it and I would have had to pay every dime. And I just said, "Could you please, please break this lease? I can't live with this woman. She's a witch." I told him, "She's a witch. She told me she's a witch and she's with all her men and all these people. And I can't live with this." And so I think the guy was probably scared the guy even. I probably scared the landlord. So he said, yeah. He said, "You can break the lease." So I managed to get out of that. And so I went forward after that. So that was a test.
So tell me,
that's my wild testimony.
So Shelly, so tell me after that, I mean, how did you find out, about what the Bible says, obviously, about, you know, Jesus, we have authority in the name of Jesus. And,
yes.
So maybe just as we, I just want to kind of just talk about, you know, a little bit about, you know, what the Bible has to say about our authority in Jesus' name. And
yes.
So how did you find out about your authority and you know, you don't have to be afraid of them. How did you learn about that?
Well, you know, when you're a baby Christian, you don't know anything. So,
right.
You know, you're either going to have to read it or go to a good church that teaches it to you or keep reading the Bible. And this guy was discipling me or feeding me. And he'd call me up and I'd call him, and I had huge phone bills. That $200 a month phone. That was back when you were paying for long distance phone calls.
Wow.
And I was calling this guy, tell me some more. And he would just he was like preaching to me. And he was studying to be a minister, so I think he probably kind of enjoyed it because I was his
disciple.
He was discipling me. And you need to do this and read the Bible, and you need to pray and get some Christian music and worship God. And so I just started trying to figure it out. You know, I mean, you got to figure this stuff out. This is something new. My family never did it. I mean, I'm the only one in my family. And they're all going to say, what happened to her? And my dad and mom thought I was in a cult because I had changed so much. And I said, you know, I would talk about Jesus. And I wouldn't go to any bar anymore. And I was like a different person. And, oh, she's in a cult. She's in one of them Christian cults. Oh, they've done something to her. And I said, I got Jesus in my heart and they don't. So they knew there was something different. And I was letting my light shine, writing them letters, and I was really going off the deep end. I probably overdid it in the beginning, but I was zealous for the Lord, but I wasn't very smart about it. But I was zealous, like the Bible says.
Yeah.
But so, I had to just go to church and read the Bible and find out. But I went to a good church, Mac Hammond. I went to Mac Hammond for a while, and I felt like I was in a Bible college there.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. Yeah. Well, and you know, the Bible talks about our authority in Jesus, and
yes,
you know, it's so important. In fact, I just feel like as we, talk more about this is in it to read Luke 10, and this is out of the Passion Translation. It says, when the 70 missionaries returned to Jesus, they were ecstatic with joy, telling him, Lord, even the demons obeyed us when we commanded them in your name. Jesus replied, while you were ministering, I watched Satan topple until he fell suddenly from heaven like lightning to the ground. Now you understand that I have imparted to you all my authority to trample over his kingdom. You will trample upon every demon before you and over every power Satan possesses. Absolutely nothing will be able to harm you as you walk in this authority. However, your real source of joy isn't merely that spirits are subject to your authority, but that your names are written in the journals of heaven and that you belong to God's kingdom. This is the true source of your authority. Then Jesus, overflowing with the Holy Spirit's anointing of joy, exclaimed, Father, thank you, for you are Lord supreme over heaven and earth. You have hidden the great revelation of this authority from those who are proud, those wise in their own eyes, and you have shared it with those who humbled themselves. So, yeah, I mean, that's in the Passion, in the King James or New King James says that, you know, behold, I give you power to tread upon serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, nothing by any means to harm you. Amen. So we have authority in the name of Jesus, and that's really important. And I don't know about you, but, you know, as you've come to know the Lord, how many years ago was that, Shelly?
Well, it's at least 28.
30. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So quite a few years.
At least. Yeah.
Yeah. So you've been learning the word since then and, understanding all your authority. Yeah. So maybe just talk about, what does that mean to you having authority and, not being afraid of these things anymore,
Terrors
being afraid
by
of
night.
Witches.
Yeah.
Yeah. So talk about that.
I worked with some after that. I worked with a few and I'd go in the bathroom and pray and they knew I was a Christian. they're around. And they will pull pranks on you. They love to harass people and pull pranks and different things. And, but you know, I was filled with the Holy Spirit and I pray in other tongues, like the Bible says.
So maybe talk about that. You know, it says in Acts 1:8,
yes,
that you receive power after
the Holy Ghost comes upon you.
Amen.
And yes, and there's scriptures in Acts, be filled with the Spirit. And the Apostle Paul says to be filled with the Spirit, and above all, pray in tongues, you know, and anyway, that's the full gospel, gospel, everything. You want everything from God. You don't want just a little piece of bread. You want it all the pie.
Yeah.
And about 6 months after I got Jesus, I got filled with the Spirit, and God led me to another church that I walked in the door and they were all praying in tongues. And I thought, what is this? I mean, I came from Lutheran background and I never saw anybody pray in tongues. And that one church that I went to was just a born again church, kind of like a Baptist church in a way. It was non-denominational. But then I was led to go to this other church, and I walked in the door and all these people were praying in tongues. And I thought, what is this? I want it. And because I was always hungry for God. And I walked in and I was by myself. And I wanted everything. I wanted everything from God. And so I would sit in this sanctuary. They had one sanctuary that they prayed for a half an hour or an hour before they went into their other sanctuary to have their service with the message and the music. And they had worship music in this other room. And I just sat there because I didn't know how to pray in tongues. And so I just sat and listened to them and looked around, and I thought, what is this? And then I was friends with this couple gals that were there. I got to be friends with them. And she says, well, I'll help you. I'll help you get this. And I said, yeah, I want it. I could see. I said, there's something with this. I can feel it. And so anyway, I did get baptized. They call it baptism of the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in other tongues. And it's in the Bible. So if you believe the whole Bible, it's in there.
Amen. There's a lot of scriptures about speaking in other tongues. It's in Jude 20. It says, beloved, building yourself up in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost.
Amen. Yes. Yeah. And when I was in Colorado, I got to meet some charismatic Catholics. And, you know, there are charismatic Catholics, and you can find them. They're a small group, but they are there. And I went praying with them, and they were very powerful in their prayers.
I remember in the 80s, this is in the, you know, during the charismatic renewal, you know, when, I mean, there was Catholics and Lutherans just getting spirit filled. And we went into a church. It was a Catholic church, and literally everybody was praying in the Spirit, or they were underneath the Spirit, literally on the floor, you know, fell underneath the power of God. It was powerful things like that happening. And, you know, the Holy Spirit is, it says you receive power after the Holy Spirit comes upon you. In Acts 2:8, it says, or 2:4, it says that when the Holy Spirit came upon them, you know, that they began to prophesy, and, you know, they even looked like they had been drinking, because they were just so out. There was such an outward appearance of joy and prophesying and all kinds of things happening. So,
And Jesus touches you, you get filled. Yes.
Yeah.
And when I was at Mac Hammond's church, the evangelist there in that church, I recommend anybody to go there. We went out two by two in busloads, and we'd come back in, and he prayed, and the anointing, we were on the floor. And it's like you said, they say in the Bible, they appeared to be drunken, but it was really filled with the Spirit of God. And he gives you joy and happiness and with that. Yeah. And other people don't know about it. They most of my family, the happiness they get is from drinking alcohol, which will give you a little buzz, but this is nothing like the Lord.
No. The Holy Spirit, when the Holy Spirit comes, I mean, he's the great teacher. The Bible says in Acts, or in John 14, you know, 15, 16, talks about the Holy Spirit. You know, he's the helper. You know, Jesus said, Yeah, he said, don't leave here until you've been endued with power from on high. And it says the Holy Spirit will, he's the helper, he's the teacher, and he'll teach you all things and show you things to come. So, you know, yes. To me, I mean, I can't daily, I just depend upon the Holy Spirit to teach me and help me. You know, he's yes. there to help us.
Guide so. You, lead me every day. Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. Yeah. So, well, you know, as we wrap up the program today, what I'd like to do is read from Deuteronomy 18. I think it's real important and that we share with people about, you know, the witchcraft. I know, you know, when I was a kid, again, I didn't know anything about witchcraft. I didn't know anything about Jesus. But we went over to my cousin's house and they had a Ouija board and they wanted to do the Ouija board. And I remember,
yes,
it was a very evil thing. It was an evil thing.
Yes.
I didn't know it at the time.
I did that too.
Yeah. It was a very bad thing to do. Because you're opening yourself up to demons to come in and to torment you. And the thing the Bible says that Satan comes to kill, steal, and destroy, but Jesus yes. came that we might have life and have it more abundantly. But the thing that you were talking about earlier is that what they'll do is they try to isolate you. You know, the Jesus talked about when that sheep goes off yeah. and all by itself, that the wolf yes. can come and devour him. Oh. Well, we are like that too. If we go off, and the enemy will try to get you isolated. That's why it's so important to have yes. a church body, to be involved in a church, and to be accountable to somebody. You mean your pastor? We're pastors, my husband and I, for 35 years. We pray for our sheep. We pray for them every morning. We pray for our church. We pray for God to protect them. We pray for health and healing. We cover them with the blood of Jesus. Every day we do that. So you need covering. And then the next yeah. thing is you need to know that, so isolation, you can't be isolated. The next thing that you talked about is how that they come for your mind. The yes. Bible says we're to cast down every evil imagination and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ, in 2 Corinthians 10 verses 4 and 5. We've got to bring every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. If we don't yes. know what the Bible says, we can't bring them captive, because Philippians 4:8 tells us what to think about: whatever is lovely and just and honest and true,
yes.
if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on those things. So we've got to know what the Bible says, or we can't. You'll have a void when you get yeah. saved. You know, yeah. you have this you know, your mind has to be renewed. Otherwise it's going to stay, you're going to stay in your soul. You know, the Bible says in 3 John 2, beloved, yeah. I wish above all things that you prosper and be in health as your soul prospers,
soul prospers.
Yes. your mind, will, and emotions. So we got to have our mind, will, and emotions renewed. Our spirit yes. is born again. We're saved, but our soul, mind, will, and emotions have to be renewed in the Word of God to, because the Bible says to put on the new man as yes. we've been born of the Spirit, but we've got to put it on, and we can't put it on until our mind. But that's the second thing that the Satan will try to do, and demons that will try to come against you. Number one, they try to isolate you. Number two, they come against your thought. The battle yes. is in the mind. So you've yes. got to be aware of that and not and fall for
deceive
those tricks.
Me too. They were yeah. trying to deceive me.
Well, yeah.
They tricked and that's, me. They tricked yeah. me to move in there.
Well, and that's yeah. deception. Deception. That's the only thing Satan has,
the
is
devil.
Lies.
Yeah. Lies.
Lies. He just has lies. So that's why it's important that we've got to know the Word. If you don't know the Word, you can't know. You can't, if you know, they say, you know, you don't study a counterfeit, you know, a dollar bill or $100 bill. You study
the
real
thing.
You got to study the real thing. So we've got to study the real thing. So anyway, I want to just read from Deuteronomy 8:9. I think it's real important that people know this, because if you're playing with the Ouija boards, if you're playing with tarot cards, yes. you're playing with you know, horoscopes, messing with them, you're opening the door to the devil.
Yes.
And this is what God warned his people in the Old Testament. He said, when you come into the land, which the Lord your God is giving you, you shall not learn to follow the abominations of those nations. Abominations is really the worst thing in God's eyes. I mean, literally, it is just like the sewer to God. It's terrible. And he said, there shall not be found among you anyone who makes his son or daughter pass through the fire, or one who practices witchcraft, or a soothsayer, or one who interprets omens, or a sorcerer, or yes. one who conjures spells, or a medium, or a spiritist, or one who calls up the dead. for all those who, for all who do these things are an abomination to the Lord. And because of these things, the Lord your God drives them out from before you. He said in Deuteronomy 18, 13, you shall be blameless before the Lord. For these nations which you will dispossess, listen to soothsayers and diviners. But as for you, the Lord your God has not appointed such for you. So God's, you know, wants us, he said, be separate and come out from among them.
Come out, yes.
We can't be, you know, serving God and the devil at the same time.
No.
You know?
I know. And I was kind of like in the middle of the road. But, you know, I did repent. I had one of those Ouija boards when I was little. And after I learned how bad they were, I took it out of my mother's house and threw it in a dumpster.
Yeah.
Because she thought it was just a game. And she had bought it for me.
Yeah.
She didn't know.
Yeah. Well, most people don't have any idea, you know, in the book
repent.
Of Acts.
You have to repent of it too.
Yeah, you do.
I said, I don't have any ties with this at all.
Yeah.
Repent for even doing it.
Well, and in the book of Acts, that's exactly what they did. They brought all of their magic arts and books, the Bible says, and they burned them. They threw them in the fire. And it was worth, I mean, it was a great amount of money of things that they brought, you know, their magic arts and stuff. So yes, we need to repent. I mean, you can't keep them around your house. It's like you're opening the door to the devil for those things. So if they, in the book of Acts, they burned them. So
I would encourage
you to burn them, get rid of them, you
get
know,
rid of them. Yes.
Get rid of them. And like you said, repent.
And because, that Harry Potter's right in there with them.
Yeah, exactly. It is.
Planting seeds.
Yeah. Yeah.
You
yeah,
put
yeah.
seeds in somebody's heart and seeds grow up.
Well, seeds produce after their kind. So.
Yes. Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Well, and even I was in Costco the other day and I couldn't believe in the book area, how many demonic things and, you know, all these games the kids are playing and stuff. They just think it's harmless, but again.
Yeah, they think it's harmless. I know. My cousin says, I have control over my mind. I don't let that affect me, but you're planting those seeds.
Well, and the doors are being opened. That's why God says, he said, don't do it. He said, you
guard your eye gate.
Yeah. Well, yeah. And he said, you know, you don't put those things before you, before your eyes. So,
right.
So
and there's more witches around than people know. That's another thing I want to tell people. I worked with a few and then I was in San Francisco one time and one chased me. She must've knew in the spirit realm that we were Christians and they're in the spirit realm too, but they're not of good. They're in the evil, whatever you want to call it, realm. Mm-hmm. But they are around and they hold classes in California. This one gal was putting up a sign on a bulletin board, witches classes, join them, join in.
Well, I mean, even programs today are all about glorifying it. You know, again, people need to know, you know, people have to realize that if you're going to either be on God's side or the devil's side, you can't be, you know, in the middle. You know, straddling the fence because, you know, it's not going to work out well for you.
Yes.
But if you know Jesus, like you said, if you know Jesus, then you have authority. In fact, I want to read 1 John talks about, you know, God hasn't given us a spirit of fear in 1 Timothy 1:7. You know, it says perfect love casts out fear. In 1 John and we got it right here, 4:8. It says, there is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear because fear involves torment. And that's exactly what the devil tries to do. He tries to torment people with fear. And it's called a spirit of fear for a reason. But God said he's not giving you a spirit of fear, but a power, love, and a sound mind. A spirit of fear is just that. It's something where you open the door and you allow it in. And it's through thoughts that you allow those things in. If you continue to meditate on those fear thoughts, fear brings torment and it opens the door. So you've got to get rid of those fear thoughts. If you are just thinking about fear, 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 fear grows. Whatever you focus on will grow in your life. That's why you got to focus on faith. Faith comes by hearing and hearing the word of God. Well, fear comes by hearing and hearing the word of the devil. So if you're going to be led by the Holy Spirit of God, you've got to hear the voice of the Holy Spirit. You got to hear God's word and you got to get into it to hear it. But perfect love is, casts out fear. What does the Bible say? God is love. God is love. And so when you know, and then it says perfect love casts out fear. So if you want to be rid of fear, perfect love, you have to get to know the one who is perfect love. And that's Jesus. Perfect love, getting to know Jesus, it will cast out every bit of fear. You know, you can lay in bed tonight and the Bible says he gives his beloved sweet sleep. You can sleep in peace, knowing there's perfect peace. He whose mind is stayed on him shall have perfect peace.
Perfect peace.
Perfect peace.
But you have to be born again in order to enter into the kingdom of heaven.
Amen. So I want you to be. So I'd like you to just take a minute or two just to go ahead and lead people that are watching today into into, you know, knowing Jesus.
Salvation. Yes. Amen. Okay. All you have to do, and you really have to mean it. You have to mean it. This is no fake thing, or you have to mean it with all your heart. And you just say, Lord Jesus, come into my heart. I know I'm a sinner and I know you died for me, and ask him to forgive you of all your sins. And if you want to name some of them off, you can, or just say, I know the sins I've done. Forgive me of my sins and ask him to come into my heart. I know you come in and live inside of me by the Holy Spirit, and you're going to be a different person, and lead me and guide me every day and what to do, and take my life and use me in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. That is the good news. The Bible says that's the gospel. The gospel is
gospel,
good news.
Jesus Christ. Yeah.
Amen. Amen. I remember receiving Jesus when I was 14, and you know, he put joy in my heart. He put
14.
Love in my heart.
Oh, good.
Yeah. And so, you know, I've ever since that time, I just want to tell everybody I know about Jesus, because, he is so real to me. And you know, the Bible, I love that song where it says every day with Jesus gets sweeter than the day before, because that's exactly what happens when you get to know Jesus. It's it's not a religion, it's a relationship. And I mean, you know, and in a relationship, you grow. You know, I've been married to my husband for 46 years. We didn't start off in a relationship at the beginning. You know, it was like we had to learn about each other. We had to learn each other's likes and dislikes. Well, same with the Lord. We've got to learn what he loves, because when I love somebody, I want to please them and I want to love what they love and hate what they hate. And that takes
time.
And
you hear his voice.
Yeah.
My sheep know my voice.
Yeah.
You get to learn his voice.
Yeah. Amen.
Right.
Amen. And he leads us, you know, Romans 8:14 says, as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God.
Sons of God.
Yeah. And that's the good news. That's the good news.
Hallelujah.
Yes,
hallelujah. Yes.
Well, go ahead and, you know, share about how to receive the Holy Spirit too. Cause I think people that are watching need to know about not only being saved, but what does the Holy Spirit, how to receive the Holy Spirit.
Yes. Well, I just prayed with a gal. And they just say, you know, fill me, Holy Spirit, come upon me, ascend upon me, descend upon me, and fill me with your Holy Spirit. And it's in the book of Acts. And you have to kind of open your mouth and you have to just attempt to pray. You can't just sit there. You have to, and pretty soon it just comes out of your mouth. I remember I went walking down a nursing home, praying in the night shift, walking down the hall in tongues. But, Amen. You know, you just ask the Lord to fill you with the Holy Spirit, baptize me in the Holy Spirit, and ask him, and let somebody pray with you. And you have to move your mouth. You have to let the words come out. Some people don't know, they just don't know how to do it or what to do. And it may sound funny in your ear at first, and the devil will want to say, oh, that's stupid. That's stupid. You can't do it. And you do it. You move your mouth and let the sounds come out, and believe that Jesus is going to baptize you by the Holy Spirit, because he wants to do it. And you have to believe, and, you know, and the more you do it with your tongue, it gets more and more and better and better.
Yeah.
Increases.
It's everything we receive. The Bible says we just live by faith. So as a Christian, we're living by faith.
Yes.
As a unbeliever, you're living by fear. But when you become born of the Spirit, you get to live by faith. And, you know, it says in Romans 8:26, it says, likewise, the Spirit, the Holy Spirit of God, also helps us in our weaknesses. That's what I love about the Holy Spirit. I mean, I am weak.
Yeah.
In everything. I just say, Lord, I can't do anything without you. You know, John 15:5, Jesus said, without me, you can do nothing. So I literally take him at his word. But he said here in Romans 8:26, likewise, the Spirit also helps us in our weaknesses. And I tell you what, if you're feeling weak today, the Holy Spirit is there to help you in your weakness. He said, for we do not know what we should pray for as we ought. You know, we only have so much language in the English language to pray. We right. don't know how to pray, but right. the Spirit himself makes intercession for us utterance. With groanings, which cannot be uttered. Yes. So he prays through us. The Bible yes. says in 1 Corinthians 14, he said that when we pray in the Spirit, we're praying directly to God, that our understanding is unfruitful. So yeah, you're going to school. My understanding doesn't understand that, but I'm praying in the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit will just flow through you. And he says in making intercession is actually praying. You're praying for things you don't even know.
And that building up your spirit man too.
You're building up
your spirit inside.
Yes, that's what it says in Jude 20. Beloved, building up yourself on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. And then it says
in the Holy Ghost.
Amen. And then in Ephesians says that, you know, we can sing in the Spirit. We can pray in the Spirit. We can sing in English in our understanding. We can sing in the Spirit. We can pray in the Spirit, or we can pray it with our understanding. So it's just like for me to pray in my understanding, I have to put voice to it. I can think about it, but I have to give it voice. Same with the Spirit. When we ask the Holy Spirit, well, then we have to give voice to it. So, So Father, we just thank you right now. Let's just pray. Father, we just thank you for the Holy Spirit.
Thank you, Jesus.
Father, we thank you for the anointing, the power of your Spirit.
Thank you,
Father, we thank you for those watching. Father, I thank you for the authority that's in the name of Jesus. Lord, I thank you for the blood of Jesus. I thank you, God, that you, Lord, we just pray and break the spirit of fear over people that are watching in Jesus' name. We break the spirit of fear. We break the spirit of blinding. Yes, we break the spirit of witchcraft off of people's
witchcraft,
minds in Jesus' name. And Jesus Father, we just name. Plead the blood, and we thank you, God, that the blood of Jesus, Lord, you took away our sin. You washed us clean, white as snow, Lord. And there's no judgment against us any longer, because Jesus, you took the judgment was placed upon you from the Father, because you became sin for us who knew no sin, though, so we could become the righteousness of God. And Lord, when we come before you in your very presence, you don't see us, but you see Jesus. You see the blood of Jesus. So we thank you, Lord, that as we enter into your holy place right now, through the blood of Jesus, that you see Jesus's blood. You don't see us. You don't see our sin. We can come boldly in, the Bible says, into your very presence because of the blood of Jesus. So I thank you, Lord, for those watching today. Lord, may they get a revelation of what you did for them on the cross, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. May they get a revelation of Jesus. May they get a revelation of the Holy Spirit of power. May they get a revelation in your word today, Lord. Yes. I pray for a spirit of wisdom and revelation knowledge to be poured out upon them, Lord. In Jesus' name. Father, I thank you that the eyes of their understanding are enlightened. They know the hope to which you call them.
Remove the scales.
Yes, in Jesus' name, they know the hope to which you've called them. They know the exceeding greatness of your power towards them in Jesus' name. And they know the riches of the glory of their inheritance in you in Jesus' name. So, Father, we just send forth your word, Father God. We thank you that your angels hearken unto the voice of your word, and we are the voice in the earth. We are your body. We are your mouthpiece. We are your hands and your feet. So, Lord, in Jesus' name, we just send forth your word, Lord, to those who need healing and deliverance. We just say, be free, be healed, be delivered. Psalm 107:20, he sent his word and healed you and delivered you from destruction. So whatever you're facing today, we send forth the word of God, and we say, be healed, be delivered in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you for the blood of the everlasting covenant, that we have a covenant with you, Almighty God, and it was sealed in the blood of Jesus, Lord. And we have legal authority and legal rights because of the blood. Thank you, so thank you, God. May all those watching today revelation knowledge of this in Jesus' name.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah. Amen, amen. Well, God is good. And you know, it's so powerful. So powerful. Thank you, Shelly. Your testimony is amazing.
Thank you.
And God is so good.
I know it. Yeah.
Amen.
When I heard you said you interviewed people with their testimony, I knew right away I was supposed to ask you.
Amen. Praise God. Well, it was awesome. It's awesome. Thank you so much. And you're welcome. Anything in closing you'd like to say before we close the program today?
Well, I'm doing a prayer group online or on the phone, and the Lord's just leading me into more ministry too.
Ah, so how do they get a hold of you if they want to join the prayer group? Do they have
they could send in a messenger on Facebook.
Okay.
If somebody wants to join, it's I'm doing it at 7 o'clock at night, and not every night, but almost every night. If I work, then I can't do it. But
is it like on the phone?
Can join,
you said?
And we all pray.
Is that on
That's
the phone?
On the phone. Yeah.
Ah,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Praise God.
Yeah, and then he's telling me right now that I'm supposed to start a ministry to feed the poor. In my area, where I don't know how that's going to start, but it's going to start pretty soon.
Amen. Amen.
Help people with food.
Yeah. Well, and whatever he puts in your heart, he'll show the way. Amen.
Show me the way. He leads you and guides you. Yes.
Amen. That's awesome. Thank you so
much,
Shelly. Praise God.
Yeah.
So tonight, I just want to say for all of you that are watching tonight, if you'd like to watch more programs, you can go to lindacross.com and see other programs that I've created. I have a Thought for Today, Rise and Shine, and a Purpose, Passion, Potential Planning group once a month that I do a little show on that too. So I encourage you to take a look at those and like my Facebook page and subscribe so that I need to get up to 1,000 subscribers so I can do live streaming on my phone, which will be awesome when I'm out and about.
Oh,
so thank you so much, Shelly.
I'll
appreciate it.
Thank
you. So thank you so much. And for those on Sunday morning, we have a live stream. You can go to Living Hope CFC. That's Living Hope. And it stands for Christian Family Church, livinghopecfc.com. And watch our live stream at 10 o'clock Central Time. We encourage everybody to do that as well. So everybody, thank you for watching tonight. It's been a joy and a pleasure to talk with you, Shelly. And
thank you. Yeah,
yes.
It's been fun.
Yes, thank you so much. So praise God. Well, you have a great, awesome rest of your night and rest of your week.
Yeah, thank you.
Amen. God bless you. Bye-bye.
Bye.